I can show exactly how to expose the facet joint. But this is the cranial part.
Yeah.
This is C1R and this is C2. Now first thing I have to do is, you know, trace a lane which becomes the road. So the lane is upper border of the C2. So you have to trace it, go laterally. So the lane becomes a road. Now you can see this is the lateral part of the road. This is the medial part of the road.
Yeah.
And we have reached to the house, which is actually the facet joint. Okay, now you have to understand there is bleeding only from 3 points here. There is no bleeding from the 4th point. There are only 3 points which is bleeding. First, this is very important to understand. First point of bleeding is epidural.
Yeah.
So when we are cauterizing here, when these epidural veins are retracting inside, you will have bleeding from inside. So to control this epidural bleeding, you have to take a gel foam which is a dry and push it in the epidural spaces like this. The second point of bleeding is lateral. So if you pass the monopolar more lateral, it will bleed. So you should not go so lateral, but you can always put some gel foam there. All you have to do is just follow the upper border of the C2 lamina. And now you are seeing the C2 root. Now C2 root, you can preserve it if it is very thin, if it is not hypertrophied. You can just take a nerve root retractor like in this case, retract it up like this, and then you do not have to cut it. Now the third point of bleeding is between the C2 and the lateral mass of the C1.
Yeah.
This is the third point of bleeding. Okay, so when you start dissecting superior to the C2 root, that is where it starts bleeding.
Yeah.
There is no fourth point of bleeding, that's it. There are only three: epidural, lateral, above the C2 root. Over the joint space, it very rarely, you know, kind of bleeds. So in many cases the C2 root is hypertrophic and it occupies exactly in front of the joint. Only in those cases you may have to cut it. But now I am finding that in many other cases you can start preserving it. So now you have seen the joint getting exposed. You can see the joint now.
Yeah.
So you see, this is the lane. This is a sharp lane. It's a small lane which kind of turns and now becomes the highway. You can see this highway now. This is the lateral part, this is the medial part. And this is the house, which is actually the facet joint.
Yeah.
The base of the house is the joint. You can now put it, you can open it up like this. And now you can also drill it. You can do whatever you want. Now I will show you how to put a screw in C1 and C2. It's very straightforward. This is the medial part, this is the lateral part. Okay. Now this is where we start the traditional power screw. This is where we put a subarticular screw.
Yeah.
I will not recommend a subarticular screw because it's going to be very close to the joint and it will make putting a spacer very difficult. I will not recommend putting it too low down because you are having increasing the risk of the vertebral artery.
Yeah.
So this is a traditional point, this is a subarticular. Okay.
Yeah.
So somewhere in between here. So before the road becomes flat, you know, there is an up and there is a flat portion. This is the up portion and this is the flat portion.
Yes, sir.
So before it becomes flat, just below that, maybe 3.5 to 4 millimeters below that, because that is the diameter of the screw.
Yeah.
That is where you can start the tunnel. And the tunnel has to go under the house. So now, when you are using this, you can see that it's kind of curving inwards. Maybe about 2 to 3 degrees. So naturally your drill will also curve inwards by 2 to 3 or 3 to 4 degrees. So you don't require an II at all. Don't go on exposing an II. It's one of the simplest techniques you can do. And just put in the length. Once you put in all the 4 screws, then you can take an II.
Yeah.
But saying this, if you're starting to do for the first time, you can use II, but then understand technique doesn't require an II. So I am putting it in 18 millimeters, but the exact length has to be calculated on the CT scan.
Yeah.
Now you also have to understand that pushing the C2 inside is not bad and pulling the C1 outside is not bad. But you should not pull the C2 and push the C1. That is bad. So now I put the screw. So you can see it's kind of starting in the parts, then going very fast into the pedicle. Now you can see the C2 ganglia.
Yeah.
So we will try to preserve it. Okay.
Yeah.
Now the C2 ganglia can be dissected downwards, because that is the natural position of the C2 ganglia, between both the screws. Now this is the third point of bleeding.
Yeah.
When you pull down the C2 ganglion and when you dissect here, which is under the C1 arch and the lateral mass, here you have once again venous flexes which are coming from draining to the cord and going laterally. So this is the third point of bleeding. So this is not such a big problem. Okay?
Yeah.
So now I have exposed the lateral mass of the C1. This is the arch of the C1 over here. This is the junction of the lateral mass and the arch of the... Now the vertebral is above the C1 arch.
Yeah.
So some people say that you can put a screw through the arch and all that. Now that is slightly dangerous and sometimes can be tricky. Anyhow, to lift the vertebral artery. But the safest point to put the screw is at the junction of the lateral mass and C1 arch over here.
Mm.
You know, this kind of forms a natural obstructive barrier for this and kind of holds it. So this is the lateral part, this is the medial part, this is the midline. Now maybe 2 degrees laterally. Venous bleeding has been overrated. It doesn't bleed. If you follow these principles, it doesn't bleed at all. So you should always feel with the sound, so that you know you're not going through any kind of this one. Now can I have a screw, 18 millimeter screw? Now this C1 screw, you know, you have to pull up the C1 slightly upwards. Upwards is backwards. So whenever you are putting a C1 screw, this step is very important. You have to take an Allis forceps. You have to put it on the, because if you're going to push while putting the screw, it can cause significant cord compression. So you have to hold it and your assistant has to counter pull it upwards when you're putting it. So when it's pulling it counter in a counter manner, that is when you can apply the screw. So now the distance what you measure, you should add about 5 millimeters for the C1 screw. Because the C1 screw is actually over the ledge of the C1 arch. So you have to add about 5 to 6 millimeters on that.
Yeah.
Then furthermore, when you are inserting it, you would like the C1 to come backwards and the C2 to go forwards. So that, you know, the bends is completely reduced. In which case, if the C1 has to be pulled back, means posteriorly, the screw of the C1 should be little bit more anterior to the C2 screw, so that when you tighten it, the C2 screw can automatically get pulled backwards. So that's why when you put it, they should not be in the same height. So the C2 should be at a slightly higher level, the C1 should be at a slightly lower level. Now placement of this screw has got nothing to do with the landmarks of the screw. And usually they will be in the same line, even if they are slightly away, doesn't matter, because it's only 2 screws. Being in the straight line becomes an issue if there are 3 screws. But 2 screws, it doesn't matter. But what is important is when you're putting the C1 screw, the C1, you have to put an Allis and pull it upwards. And the C1 screw should be at a more, means from this perspective, it has to be at a deeper level than the C2 screw. True. So you can place something like this, retractor, retracted spacer. Okay, now it can slightly countersink inside, so that when you leave it, it doesn't come out. Remember, there is no vital structure inside. So the distractor has to be applied on the bone, not on the screw heads, because it can shear it off. Can I have a rod? I will just show you the occipital screw. Now in a DCR we place it. Now if you have to imagine as if the C1 arch has been occipitalized. So we will have to put translaminar screw. Now translaminar screw is put like a skew. So So one screw goes from below upwards and another screw goes from upward below. Basically skew are two lines in space which never meet each other, even though they are not parallel. So skew means there are two lines in space which never meet, even though they are not parallel. So one line should go like this for inferior superior, then other line will go from superior to inferior. And both the screws, they come in more or less in the midline. I will put in one screw. And once again, for this you don't require an eye to go slightly from the opposite side. Now from this side you can measure how much of translaminar screw is to be put. So something like this is the length. Okay. So yeah, this is coming about 30 millimeters. So you can really pass a long screw. So you're putting in about 30 millimeter screw, which is a very long screw. So that is one advantage. And it really creates a very long lever arm. Okay. Give me a screw. So you have to remember that my right screw starts from the left side. So if it is a bifid, you can always shave off the bifid a bit. Okay, so now that is the screw. So now let me show you. Now occiput, the temporary occipital screw should be as high as possible. Give me a 10 mm screw. So my temporary screw will go as high up as possible. Then what I do is, because we do most of the cases in OAM, so I can't have somebody to kind of try to reduce it with hand. So I take something like a rectangle. Now the reason why we need to have a rectangle is so that when we compress the wire, the CV2 doesn't get pulled backwards. It goes only in the superior direction. So I have taken a braided stainless steel. Now if you have seen, I have not cut the muscles under the C2 spine, okay? So the muscle band under the C2 spine is intact. You should not shave off the muscles because they give a good holding for the wire. So I pass this wire sublaminarly. So now you kind of go on the rectangle which you have performed. So now I am started my compression. You will notice that the C2 now starts moving cranially.
Yeah.
See, if I try to wire it with this directly, you are kind of trying to pull the C2 up. Yeah. The C2 up is kind of disastrous because you know the tensor is going to move backwards. So whole idea of the compression and extension is the C2 should go cranial direction rather than coming up in a posterior direction. Rectangle, while preserving the lever arm, changes the direction of motion of C2.
Sir.
That is the function.
Yeah.
So now you can see that the C2 has moved up significantly. So in this position, now you can do an occipital fixation. Okay, so I can take something like 40 millimeters. So that should be okay. So you have to understand, there is no conflict between Goel's technique and the DCR.
Yeah.
C1 is not fused, C1, C2. C1 is fused with BI and AD, that is where you do a DCR. Now, when I am doing the putting the screw, it should be as close to the midline as possible. So normally I put in the occiput up to 12 to 14 millimeters. Don't be afraid that it goes slightly onto the inner table. Even it does plop out a few millimeters on the inside of the table, doesn't matter. So once this is tightened, that is where we remove the constructs. Now you can go and put it on the other side. So once again,
yes, sir.
C1 is occipitalized, obviously you have to do an occipito-cervical fusion. Okay, so I don't do C1, C2 if the C1 is occipitalized. There's no point. Yeah. Because of the reasons I explained to you, that the occiput and the C1 forms dangerous to put a C1 because of lot of venous plexus as well as anomalous vertebral arteries in this case.
Yeah.
And you know, it will be very deep down. So putting an occiput screw is much better. Now, the most advantageous part is this, that the spacer is here. The spacer now between the OC1 and the C2 is here. Now, from here till here forms the liver arm for the occiput.
Yeah.
You can see that huge liver arm which we are taking.
Yes.
So now longer this arm, lesser is the force between the screw and the bone. So yeah, more is the retaining capacity of the screw. Now if I have to put a part screw and connect occiput to part screw, the lever arm for the part screw would be only from here till here. So there is going to be an enormous amount of force on this. So let me give you an idea. Let us say this distance from here is 6 centimeters. Let us say this distance from here is 1 centimeter. So if the force here is 1 newton, here it is going to become 6 newtons. And this screw is not going to bear the weight of 6 newtons. You can possibly, if you put a C3 and C4, okay, then it is okay. But only C2 parts is not going to bear.
Yes, yes.
Because in terms of liver arm, it is completely disadvantageous. But if you put a laminar screw, now the liver arm for this is now increasing till here. So this may not be 6, this will be 5. So if there is 6 newtons here, this can still bear. So the force is much less. And as you can see, it's a very low profile screw. So one more screw will come like this from here to here. And you can see, you can feel it. Absolutely, it's the pins are starting to come off, but this screw will not come off. Am I clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay.